Hi guys, and welcome back to another IBRACORP video. Thanks for tuning in with us today. Just a quick shout out to all my subscribers. Thank you very much for your support. I've also received some donations, which has been really fantastic. I really, really appreciate it. It just helps us get the motivation to keep going and keep helping everybody out in the community. So today we are going to talk about installing Home Assistant. We're going to do it a little bit differently, and I'll show you some extra settings that will make your life a little easier. Once we've got it up and running, I'll take you through the dashboard briefly. I'll also show you how to install it on Unraid using a disk image rather than an ISO and instead of Docker. So the reason we want to go with the virtual machine option is because Home Assistant actually is packaged as an operating system in itself on Linux. But as an OS, it gives you a lot more control of its features. Whether you're running it on Docker or running it hosted within a VM, it's not as powerful and doesn't give you as much control as having it as its own OS, which they provide you. So what is Home Assistant? So Home Assistant provides a central point where all of your Internet of Things devices can communicate and be monitored. And it's really, really powerful. You know, for example, I've got a laser printer. As far as I knew, I've just had to connect to the printer and print. But with Home Assistant, it gives me all sorts of sensor data on the printer that I can access and read. For example, how much ink is left and how much printing's been done. Apart from that, you can also control obviously all your smart devices. So you can have all your smart devices in one area. That includes your Google Home, your Alexas, etc. You can even send text commands to speak on your Google speaker. And let me tell you, my partner wasn't too happy when she heard that sitting in the middle of the kitchen the other day. So we've got Home Assistant's main page up at the moment, home-assistant.io. Just a brief look. Open source home automation that puts local control and privacy first. Powered by a worldwide community of tinkerers and DIY enthusiasts. Perfect to run on a Raspberry Pi or a local server. Now it's worth noting that you can actually have this on a Raspberry Pi, and if you have wireless built in, it can act as a wireless connection as well. So you don't have to have it wired in a server per se, but whether that's the method that we're going to use today because we don't have a Raspberry Pi and we want to use it on our Unraid server. So here's a couple of notes on the product itself. Home Assistant will track the state of all devices in your home so you don't have to. You can control them all on your phone as well using their apps. And you can automate stuff in the app as well. So, you know, why not dim the lights when you start watching a movie on your Chromecast? There's plenty of support for different products and services here, which is really, really cool. So guys, let's get stuck into it. Okay, so we're on the install page now. This is the official page here. And there's a couple of different options that you'll see when you first arrive on the page that allow you to install this. So the first is an image. And these are the devices the images are for. And the next is a virtual appliance. So you've got VMDK, VHDX, VDI, QKL2, and OVA. Now, some people have used the QKL2 virtual appliance here, and that also works, guys. There's no one is better than the other. But in my case today, I'm going to show you how to use a VMDK. And the reason why is sometimes you might have VMDK for other OSs that you might want to use on your Unraid. So we're going to show you how to use that so that it's not just for Home Assistant, but any other image that uses VMDK. So if we scroll down, it starts giving you instructions on how to install. Now, we could read this, but it's not going to translate directly to Unraid for us. So we're just going to go through and look at it using Unraid. So the first thing you want to do is download the VMDK. If I just scroll back up here under virtual appliance, we'll just download this. So we've downloaded the file here. As you can see, it's about 237 megabytes, not too big. The first thing we're going to need to do is extract it. So if you're using WinRAR or something similar, you can just right click it and click extract to, and it'll create a folder just like this one. And then you can see our VMDK is there. So we've got that ready. So the next thing we want to do is go to our Unraid server. So I'm on our Unraid server here, I've signed in, and we've gone to VMs. Now, if you don't see this, it will say that VM option is switched off. Simply go to Settings, VM Manager, and make sure that Enable VMs is ticked to Yes, and hit Apply. So back in VMs, we have the option to add a VM. Before we can do that, we have to move the file to its directory where we're going to need to use it. So if you head back to Shares, you'll notice that we have the domain share. Now, domains is where, by default, unless you've changed it, your virtual disks are stored for any VMs that you operate. So as long as you've got your domain share there, click on that. And if you come down, you'll see the SMB security settings. And this is just to allow us to get to it on our File Explorer on Windows. So make sure you've got the share name, that's fine. Export is to yes. Case sensitive is auto, and security is at the moment is public. If you have it set to secure or private, it just means that you'll need to make sure you use credentials when we access it via the File Explorer. So we'll leave this on VMs, and now let's head back to our File Explorer. So first thing we'll do is copy our downloaded and extracted VMDK image for Home Assistant. We'll copy that, and we'll head to our server directory. So we've copied that now, and we've accessed the server in our Windows Explorer here. And as you can see our domains folder. So we'll just click that. And at the moment it's empty, I don't have any VMs. We'll click new folder and we'll give it a name. Now this name will be the same name that we give it in Unraid once we set up the VM. So we'll just call this Hassio, as it's sometimes known. Click on that and then paste your VMDK image. So now that that's copied, we can close our File Explorer. Head back to Unraid and click add VM. You can just pick Linux. For the name, we'll give this Hassio, just to make sure it matches our disk folder name. So for the description, we're just going to put an IP address that we'd like it to be at, that we know will always be static, and just a brief description of what it is, okay? It makes it really handy when you want to go back and look at your VMs, and at a brief glance, you can just see what its IP address is and what version you originally installed or what it is that's on there. So for the CPUs, I'll just give it these two for the CPUs. Initial memory, now this is where the documentation comes in handy. If you just scroll down, so we're using the VMDK, which is the VMware workstation, and we've unpacked it. We can see here that it says, give it at least 2 GB of RAM and 1 CPU. All right, no worries. So we'll come back here. We've given it 2 and we'll give it its minimum 2 GB. So usually when you're first setting up a VM, you might have the ISO, and this is where you would select the ISO. All right, but in our case, we don't need the ISO. It's already technically installed. We just want to load the disk that it's installed on, and that's what we copied over. So as you can see, by default, the primary VDisk location says that it's MNT user domains, Hassio, VDisk image 1. So it automatically generated this by the name that we set up here. Now we have all these folders correct already because we've created them in Windows Explorer, except for the disk image name. So we're going to click manual and you can just navigate to it. So user, domains, Hassio. You notice it won't show the disk image. That's fine. So what we want to do, and if we come back to our Explorer here, make sure you copy this exactly as it is, guys, including the file extension. And if you don't see the file extension in Windows Explorer, hit the view option up here and check file name extensions. And then we simply just put that on the end, just like that. Scroll down a little further. Your network bridge mode, you want that on BR0 if you want to expose it out and have its own IP address, which I recommend. And start the VM after creation. So just hit create. And there you go. So now it's running. And you might be wondering, how do we now access it? So as you can see back on our install guide, once you've loaded it, it should be accessible at this URL, http://homeassistant.local:8123. So as you can see, we've hit the URL now, and it's telling us that it's basically preparing. So excellent. All you have to do really is sit back at this point and just give it some time. If you can't get through using the URL, you can use the IP address. Now the IP address by default will be expected to be handed out by your DHCP. So wherever your router is, if you go back to your router, and in my case, I'm using DDWRT, under status, under DHCP, you can see the IP address that has been handed out. And there you go. So we've loaded up and it's ready for us to set up our account. So pretty straightforward. We'll enter our name. We'll enter a password. And we'll hit create account. You can pick a location, pick your time zone. All you Americans out there will probably never have to scroll down this far, but we'll just go down to Melbourne, Australia, Sydney, that's fine, and click next. So what you're seeing here is Home Assistant's all automatically picked up these products using the router. So it's found these devices on the network and it's asking us if we want to set them up. So for example, if you click Google Cast, you can say where it is and click finish. And now that's basically configured. And you can do the same for the rest. So here's our printer. We'll just click submit and we'll say it's in the living room and click finish. And welcome to the landing page. So as you can see, overview is your main dashboard and already we're picking up items that we've added. So here's the printer. It's telling us it's asleep, how many pages it's printed, how much of the drum is left, toner left, you know, all that sort of information right on first glance, which is amazing. And if you come down to configuration and click integrations, add integration, here's the list of stuff out of the box that you can basically monitor. Quite a big list. There's a lot of things in here, which is really, really cool, guys. So there's more videos on the setup of integrations out there already. I just wanted to sort of show you how to get this going. There's one more step that might help you. So the first thing you want to do is make sure that you've set a static IP address for the server. So in your router, you should be able to see the name of the device, which will be Home Assistant, the current IP address that it has, which might be different to what you want it to be, and its MAC address. You can put the MAC address in and the host name and the IP address you actually want it to be. Then go ahead and restart your server by going to VMs restart, and it should come back up on that particular IP address instead of just some random one. All right, you might have a really laid out network and you want a specific IP address for that server now so that you can put it in a directory and know that it's always available there. That's how to do it. The next step is exposing our Home Assistant out. Now, guys, I've touched on Nginx Proxy Manager many times. I'm gonna touch on it real quick once more just to show you how to get this going. So we're back in Nginx Proxy Manager here. And as you can see, we've already set up our domain and proxy for Home Assistant. So I'm just giving you a brief look at what it looks like just so you can copy it straight over to yours. So we've got the domain name, the scheme, the IP address, and the default port, which is 8123. I've checked all the options here, and I've picked a SSL certificate. So if you don't know how to do any of this stuff, guys, I've already made a video on Nginx Proxy Manager and on Cloudflare, because we also had to create a DNS in Cloudflare. So please go check that out. It's just going to help give you an overview and all that. And really, this is the most important part of having it as a operating system of itself instead of using Docker, for example, is the Supervisor feature. Now, I know you can install it separately in Docker, but this is just an all-in-one solution that's provided directly from them and is the recommended way to run it from Home Assistant Team. As you can see, you've got your snapshots, your add-on store, so you've got even more stuff here that you can pick from to install, and all your system settings. Now, I may not have mentioned it earlier, but it's also worth noting that this is a free and open source product and is worked on by heaps of people, you know, that have just a lot of love and passion for it. And it's basically a challenge towards all the proprietary and paid alternatives that offer you the same thing or sometimes less, and you have to pay for it. In this case, it's totally free, so you can run it from your home anytime. So thanks for tuning in, guys. I'll see you in the next IBRACORP video. If you have any comments or feedback, any suggestions, just leave it down in the comments below. And as usual, please like and subscribe. Thank you for your time.